I know Chuck Berry and Elvis and, like, you know, Little Richard were around before. But really, I mean, these guys changed everything forever.
Come on. This is episode 100. What are you doing?
Sorry, Brent. It's episode 100. She's trying to get it on.
Holy. What happened there?
I don't know. You know? All right, let's get things going here.
That was a nice little cameo by Holly Huard there.
Oh, H-H-H. Absolutely.
That's right. Double H.
If you didn't know
the show.
Who HH was in the chat there, folks, that was her.
There she is, making her first appearance.
That's right, first appearance. We didn't plan that at all. Look at us, centennials.
It's crazy, isn't it?
It's crazy, I know. Maybe we should just spend it just sitting here going, this is crazy, isn't this wild? Wow, episode 100? Can you believe we did it?
For 50 minutes.
Yeah,
I cannot believe it.
Look at this, 100 plus albums. Can you believe that? cool, man. Oh, geez, good. Yeah. Have you been looking forward to this one? Has it been have you been sleeping? Have you not been sleeping? Thinking about this?
I haven't slept since our last episode. Been awake the entire time.
Yeah, the only thing that could put you to sleep is a revolver.
That's right. Good work.
Don't do that. Don't do that. Leave the revolver out of it. Look at it. There it is.
There it is.
Is that a compact disc?
It is. It's a compact disc.
Wow. Look at that. And there's a booklet and an apple.
So there's like a full, see, this is what the kids are missing out on, Alex. God damn it. Look at all the stuff in here.
Hold it up this. Right there. Look at all those words on a page.
Words to read. Christ, there's all kinds of pictures. Look at that. You don't get that today.
I says, pardon?
Right.
Yeah.
Look at this, like a full gatefold and everything.
Wow.
Yeah.
Cool.
And you know what? There's loads of them.
Oh, you got them. Look at, you're a Beatle. Yeah. You would have been right there in Beatlemania, huh?
Yeah. There's all kinds. So.
That's pretty cool.
There's all kinds. Anyway.
My uncle Steve, my godfather, is a huge Beatles fan. Huge Beatles fan. I hope he's watching tonight. If there's one episode that he's going to tune into, it'll be about the Beatles.
Really?
I don't think that he's going to hear anything he already doesn't know, except for how I feel about the Beatles is going to be the only thing that he's going to learn tonight. Potentially.
We have that in common. So I'm very curious about that. Now let's provide a little bit of a preamble here. So at the beginning of our little show here, we had talked about, I don't know how it came up, but I said, yeah, and we'll do a Beatles, you know, record eventually. And you're like, no.
Yeah.
I don't like the Beatles at all.
Yeah.
And then it kind of morphed into like, well, I'm discovering all these things. So maybe, you know, maybe I'll have a look at it. And then it was like, okay, you know, show 100 is going to be the Beatles. And
it's like, the Beatles.
And, you know, we're on the road, right? And now we're here.
Ooh.
So it's been this huge buildup. I'm super excited. I haven't slept for like 2 weeks.
I know it's been a lot. It's been a while since you've got some shut eye. Well, so you chose to give me a revolver.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Do you care of more context behind this one? Why this one? We could start there as well.
Yes. So this one I think is the most important because this one really changed the way that records were made. After it, like forever, because typically a lot of things were happening. Like the studio was for a certain purpose. So it was there to record singles and it was there to record them in a certain way. right? But the Beatles spent so much time in the studio that this is their seventh record. So they thought, you know what? And they started taking LSD, by the way, and getting into like Eastern philosophy and stuff like that. And the kind of illusory idea of, you know, humanity and human existence and stuff. And they started getting really deep. And so they brought in this guy, Jeff Emmerich, who was an engineer, who was a young kid, along with George Martin, and said, let's start really kind of like fooling around with all the gear. So let's, you know, record a song, but let's speed it up and see what it sounds like. Now let's slow it down and see what it sounds like. Now play it backwards and see what it sounds like. And so they use things like tape looping. They, you know, sped up, slowed down. They used very speed. Like they did all kinds of stuff. And Revolver came from that. And no one had done anything like that before.
I guess not, right? 66. Like not much. That wouldn't have really been, you'd have to be really like innovative or just even well off enough to be like, let's go into the studio and mess around and see what happens.
And I think that that was their luxury too, because they had been so popular, right? And I think, you know, 63, they really broke. So for 3 years, they'd been in this cycle, and they were making like feature films, and then they would make a record, then they would go on tour. And it was like pop artists were believed to, you know, have to, they were believed to have been stayed like busy. Like you can't take a break because you're a pop artist. You're always like putting, you know, stuff out there. But they said, we don't have to do that anymore. And it was weird. It was the first time that, you know, a renowned pop artist took a break. And so they started writing songs and fooling around and going into the studio and doing this stuff. So they had more time to experiment. And this is a highly experimental record.
So the version I listened to was the Revolver 2022 mix. So okay. So this was, I guess, a lot AI helped in creating quite a bit of this. So, you know, with the whole like,
really?
Yeah. So Peter Jackson did, you know, the whole Get Back documentary on Disney. And so with that technology that they had, not obviously, well, to basically restore some of that stuff and some of the audio and things like that, artificial intelligence played a huge part in that. So what they did with this mix was that they used AI to hone in on the different parts, different instruments, the different vocals and things like that. And they were essentially able to separate vocals, stems from different drums, from the guitars, from the vocals, and to create a proper, essentially like stereo mix. So what you would hear before, and probably even on the CD, that compact disc you have, I guess it doesn't sound very good in headphones. Or really at all, I guess.
It just sounds very, you know, it's funny because if you turn one of the, you know, it's left channel, right channel. So it's like the old AC/DC records. If one of them drops off, you lose half the instrumentation.
Okay.
Which is really weird, right?
Yeah.
You just don't hear it.
Right.
Because it's a mono recording.
Right. Okay. Really strange. So like, that's it, right? So like that's how it was obviously originally recorded. And now a lot of things were recorded then and not recorded. With that final fidelity was not very high. So they used, as I've said three times now, AI to separate those and mix this thing. And they went in and it sounds great. I'm listening to it. I've been listening to it on these headphones and I'm like, well, this, I don't know anything other than a very well mixed Beatles album, apparently, because they were able to go in and enhance. So like they didn't redo anything. They didn't re-record anything.
Okay.
They just turned the volumes up. So
the old mastering trick. Remastered, we just turned the volume up.
Yeah.
But how does it sound, Alex?
How does it sound?
What's the verdict?
Look, I definitely had to get older. I definitely had to grow up. I definitely had to listen to 100 plus albums before getting to these guys. I don't know. Yeah, it was good. It was good. I liked Revolver. I liked it. I did.
I knew you would.
I don't know. It feels, it just feels very weird to say because like, it's like, you know, people love this album. This is like one of their best albums. So I don't know. It's a lot of really cool sounds. They definitely explored a lot. I don't really know what that's coming from, though, right? I mean, what album would this be? The fourth album, fifth album?
Seventh.
See?
Believe it or not.
So I don't know really what it's coming from, but to kind of go from Taxman into Eleanor Rigby into, like, it's very interesting the sounds that they do play with. For me, I'm not sure what that meant from where they were coming from, though.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They came from this. So this is Rubber Soul.
Yeah.
Now, on Rubber Soul, our Drive My Car, you've heard that song.
Yeah.
Maybe you can drive my car. Norwegian Wood. Nowhere Man.
Okay.
You Won't See Me. So you've probably heard Michelle. So you've heard a lot of these songs. This is where they're coming from. But the very interesting thing about this album is that Revolver is that this is the, it marks kind of the beginning of their, what's called the psychedelic period, because they started, like, it kind of indicates their interest in LSD. They started taking LSD. It was Lennon and Harrison who started. They pulled Ringo in. McCartney said, no, I'm not doing that. He kind of was more into, like, the London art scene. They took LSD, got into, like, Eastern philosophy, Hinduism, stuff like that. And again, that's kind of, you know, that was maybe the earliest beginnings of kind of the separation of the Beatles. But it's a very psychedelic record, but it's so stylistically diverse, this album. And that was one of the other reasons why I wanted to bring it in, because everything is on here. There's ballads, there's rockers, there's Hindu classical music, there's, you know.
Right. And I think where I kind of come back to where I'm like kind of where I think it's really cool is maybe not in context to where what their other albums sound like, but in context of this being 1966. And you kind of think of it and I'm like, this is all really cool stuff to be exploring and experimenting with. And you can really understand where a lot of people were inspired and why a lot of people look at the Beatles as, you know, like you say, all roads lead back to the Beatles. So
it truly, like, you know, those are kind of weighty statements to make, you know, and someone's always ready to throw a rock at you for that stuff. But I can't see it any other way. Like I truly cannot. And it's not like I have some kind of Beatles bias, but like literally everything leads back. I know Chuck Berry and Elvis and, like, you know, Little Richard were around before, but really, I mean, these guys changed everything forever.
I get it. I think I get it. I think I finally understand it somewhat.
I'm so glad. This is a true milestone, and I'm so glad that we waited to show 100 to do this, because it truly is a milestone.
I don't know what it was. I don't know what it, like, could have been, you know. It must have been this idea that, like, everybody loves the Beatles and but there are some songs that, like, you hear from them, you're like, I'm not old enough to really like that song.
Right.
I remember being a big fan of Yellow Submarine when I first heard it, and and it turns out my kids absolutely friggin' love that song too. Look at this, you know. And so I'm kind of like, why? And then that's when I get to songs like I'm Only Sleeping. And I'm like, this is probably one of the reasons why I wasn't like, I didn't get it. Right.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, I guess I feel like this about the Beatles, but everybody loved it. I don't know. It was just this weird feeling I had about them that I was like, I'm not ready for the Beatles yet.
I get that. I totally get that.
Yeah.
And it depends on kind of your entry point, right? It depends on what you hear first. Like, if you hear a song, if I heard the song Taxman, I wouldn't really be thrilled, right? I wouldn't be like, okay, give me more. If I heard Eleanor Rigby, I'd want to hear more.
Yeah, tell me more. Hey Jude, right? Like, great song.
Right.
Right?
Yeah. The other thing, too, I was saying earlier briefly that the Beatles kind of ushered in this interest in making good records, not just, like, two singles and a bunch of filler, right? So they focused on putting out a proper record. And this one has, I think, 14 songs on it. But, like, the whole record is intended to be good, not just, like, these two singles that will play on the radio and the rest is just kind of, like, you know, garbage. Yeah. So that changed, too.
Yeah. Well, and it's interesting the Beatles were, it was John who was like, screw this, like, 2.5 minute song structure, right? And I'm looking at this and it's like 14 songs, 35 minutes. It's like, mm-hmm. You got 14 songs, done under 35 minutes. And that's great to me. Like, nothing, I feel like with them, you can't, any song on this album, if it was longer than what they are, it's too long.
Mm-hmm.
Like, these songs are perfect lengths for all of them. I'm not sitting here going, I wish this was longer, or I wish that would, maybe Yellow Submarine would have been cool to have like more of a, I don't know, right? But I mean, like, technically it fades out, so it does just go on and on and on. Anyways, I just wanted to mention the length of it, with that amount of songs, is pretty pretty impressive too.
They would do later on, and maybe we'll get a glimpse at this.
Okay.
Later on, they would do all kinds of stuff. Like, they would challenge the 305 rule,
right?
The songs have to be under 305 to get played on the radio. They would just, like, the whole side two of Abbey Road is like one song, basically.
Oh, really? Well, actually, John did say he wanted to do, they were talking about this one wanting to be just a group of songs without there being any gaps in between. Like he wanted to get in. It sounds like they got it. It was pretty experimental. Like, they just had an outline of compositions, and they weren't even really sure when they got into there, I guess, how the thing was going to play out.
They just had sketches. Yeah.
Yeah.
And they liked doing that. But you saw the film, right? The Peter Jackson film, where you see Paul McCartney write Get Back in like 5 minutes.
Right.
You know, no,
I didn't watch. I started kind of watching it, and then I was like, I don't get the Beatles yet. So
you might, after we're done here, you're going to watch that, and you will be mystified. He literally wrote a classic song in 5 minutes by fooling around with, like, just noodling. Astonishing.
I could do that too. All right. So let's get, if it's that easy.
It's just that easy.
Well, and how old are they at this point too? Aren't they something like 23 or 24 or something like that?
Yeah.
Which is also incredible with a lot of these songs.
Like, yes.
Pretty wild. So, for example, Taxman. I had no idea what taxes were until I was 23, and it seems like neither did George.
Well, they found out. So they, you know, I think they got taxed 95% or something like that, right? Is like entertainers. It was called an unearned revenue or something like that.
Right.
Like, it wasn't your wage because you made these like royalties. So it was called unearned whatever revenues. And they took 95% of that.
Wow.
And that's why the Stones left the UK and went to France. They went to Nelcote.
Yeah.
And that was XL and Main Street. So the UK was very difficult on their artists.
Oof.
Yeah, that's where Taxman came from.
Well, it's a great song. I love this
song. Clever lyrics. I don't like the song very much, but the lyrics are funny.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, tax your feet.
I know. You go for a walk, we'll tax your feet.
Tax the heat. Yeah, very clever. It's cool. Like, I do love the guitar. Like, this was kind of the thing. It was like a 66. This is kind of the tone of a guitar. I mean, it's not Clapton and Blues Breakers or anything like that, but it's just kind of a cool, gritty,
kitschy.
You know? Yeah.
Yeah.
It sounds like a Sears Silvertone or something like that, you know?
Totally.
Yeah.
It sounds like the Batman theme song, right?
And there's that too. That's right. Yes. Batman.
Yeah.
Actually, I was hearing, what is the other one? Shotgun by Junior Walker and the All Stars. So if you listen to Shotgun by Junior Walker and the All Stars, it's basically Taxman. And so, yeah, this guitar solo is actually Paul McCartney on this.
It is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So this is a George Harrison tune, but Paul McCartney rips the.
And I don't know how that happened. I don't know. I have this really cool book that talks about every recording the Beatles did, like, by take. And it's like this thick. So, like, it'll say, you know, 11:56, A Day in the Life, false start. 11:56, you know, with 40 seconds, second start, false start. And so it breaks down the entire recording session. It's very, very interesting. But, like, who played what, you know, because McCartney had his hands in everything.
because they, I guess it was that like George was still coming along as a guitar player, and because Paul could play everything, that like George just couldn't get it. And that was, sorry, what is it? Jeff Emmerich was the
Jeff Emmerich, yeah, was the engineer.
So I guess he's got a book out that like he really rips on Harrison and like his ability or inability to play. And oh yeah, and just like, yeah, he was like, oh, we had to do this like over and over again because George couldn't do it, so we had to get Paul in to do it, that kind of a thing. So yeah,
really,
yeah.
Now, did you know that George was like, he liked to shoot his mouth off when he was alive? He would say, oh, well, he would say he invented chords.
It's funny because that was like the total opposite. It's like the total opposite of what Paul McCartney said. Like, he didn't take any credit. Right. He's like, he didn't even go and talk about how he played the guitar solo on this. Right. It was like, that's funny.
It's, do you really know why, Alex? Because a lion doesn't have to tell you it's a lion. Look at all the lovely
people. And then this goes into Eleanor Rigby, and it's like, mm-hmm. there's no guitar drums. It's like literally all strings, and you're like, whoa, what just happened here? What kind of an album is this? That's crazy.
Yeah.
That right. was cool. Yeah.
This is definitely one of the more powerful Beatles songs for me, just with the imagery and the lyrics, and it's almost got kind of a gothic feel, you know, and that, you know, no one was saved, and Father McKenzie writes the sermon that no one will hear. Like, it's just so heartrending, right? And you're like, oh my God, like, it's so lonely. Yeah, it's perfect.
I've heard this song before.
Oh, for sure you have, yeah.
For sure I've heard this song before.
Yeah.
But again, context is very important. And knowing where it sits here and what comes after it, and it's very cool.
That's so, right.
Yeah, good song. I'm only sleeping.
Yeah, this is kind of a funny song because, again, like, you know, Lennon's squeaky little voice comes in, and his voice doesn't normally sound like that. He was a guy who, he didn't like the sound of his voice. He would experiment to the point where, like, he would take a glass and like put it on top of the microphone and then sing just to change the intonation of the voice. Yeah.
Like, what does that even do?
Didn't like his voice. And wanted to try to sound like an old man in the song, apparently. Yeah. Jeff Emmerich said that. He said they fooled around with this for a long time. And he said he wanted to sound like a papery old man. That was his description. I don't know what that means.
Huh. This is mm-hmm. yeah, this is the guitar solo, the backwards guitar solo, mm-hmm. and this is also where Jeff Emmerich was like, you know, kind of ragging on him, oh, he could barely play the guitar solo forwards or something like that.
Oh,
or
really,
yeah. It was something like this, right? So just wow. some chirping going on, but
that's funny.
Oh, that was cool. Like, you kind of hear that and you're like, that can only be something being played backwards. And mm-hmm. again, you put it into this idea that this is happening in 1966. It's pretty revolutionary stuff. Love you too.
This is an all Harrison track, I believe.
Yeah.
And it's very
gotta be
Hindu classical. He really kind of went off that end, right? Like, Lennon kind of stayed a little stable, but Harrison, like, you know, and it all started when he played Norwegian Wood. Like, he played that sitar and he was fascinated by that. And he started taking LSD and got into, like, you know, spiritualism and Eastern philosophy and all that stuff. And he was just gone.
Mm-hmm. It's cool. I love the way it starts. It's kind of like a sitar mm-hmm. at the beginning. And mm-hmm. then it just kind of like when the hand drums come in or whatever it is that come in, it's just like everything kind of just kicks in and it's like, hey, that was cool. Yeah, to your point, you know, make love all day long. Make love singing songs like
yeah.
yeah.
I'll make love to you.
Absolutely. Yeah, yeah. It's people standing around. He'll screw you in the ground. They'll fill you in with all their sins. You'll see. I'll make love to you if you want me to. Interesting stuff. Interesting stuff. Not like the most, I don't know, prolific words, but it's...
No. All Harrison.
Yeah. Here, there, and everywhere.
On the other hand, right?
On the other hand, yeah.
Now, it's interesting because a little juxtaposition, you know, between physical and romantic love now, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So when you think about it, this is like, and this is classic Paul McCartney, like those great harmonies and that ascension and like romantic love. And like that guy, like think about songs like Yesterday and, you know, The Long and Winding Road. Like the guy is a prolific genius, probably, I would say, and like, you know, fight me, one of the greatest songwriters in the history of recorded music, if not the...
Wow. Fight me. I'm not going to. But 23. He's 23 years old.
Right.
Writing these things.
And Alex couldn't read music. Couldn't write.
He couldn't. I thought you were telling me I can't read
music. Oh, no. Sorry. I was just saying Alex.
And Alex can't read music. No, I can't. But he couldn't read music. No way.
And again, super humble. People said like, oh, my God, the compositions. And he said, it just kind of came out of my hands. I would be, you know, I'd have the tune in my head and I'd kind of figure it out. And there it was. Like, he's super humble.
But why was it, though, that were Harrison's songs just not good enough? Because to my understanding, Taxman was the sixth Harrison song on all their albums. Mm-hmm. The only song number six that he had on out of all of those.
I mean, the guy was a great songwriter, but it just so happened that he was in, you know, a band with two of the best songwriters ever. So, I mean, how's your luck, you know?
In the town where I was born, lived the man who sailed to sea.
Yellow Submarine. Love this song. I do.
It's fun. It was written as a children's song.
Good. It should be. Kids love it. I was a kid. I loved it. My kids are kids. They love it.
Yep. Again, Lennon and McCartney. Yeah. And you know who else actually wrote the lyrics for this, who helped out? Our old friend Donovan from...
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, cool. You know, Mellow Yellow, Sunshine, oh, yeah. Superman.
Yeah.
Oh, and Billion Dollar Babies.
Head is, yeah.
I'm so scared, your little head. That comes up a lot recently.
This is a couple of times. Not bad. Yeah. yeah, this is great. So this is Ringo singing.
Yeah.
Ringo really taking this one on, which is hilarious.
Yeah.
It's great how they hand things off, you know, between each of them as singers. Really works.
They would just give Ringo their handoffs or their cast-offs.
Well, I mean, this is a pretty good cast-off. Yeah, I love it when they get into, like, hearing the people on the boat and, like, you know. I can just see them, like, just, I don't know, even dressed up doing these silly things. So.
Oh, totally.
Yeah. Yeah. That was good.
They had fun.
It's funny too. I think so. This came out as a double A side, Brent. A double A side, Yellow Submarine and Eleanor Rigby.
No way, really?
Double A side. Does that mean they were both just so good that you call them two A sides?
Yeah, I guess. There's no B side.
Did I just imagine that's all the Beatles that's really funny, released were double A sides?
Oh God! They would play all these songs on the radio. Like they were all just like they would distribute all these songs as singles and DJs would just play all of them. You know, there were some that were more popular, obviously, like Rigby and stuff, but like they would play everything like Good Day Sunshine and whatever. Hmm. Yeah.
What about She Said, She Said?
Yes, they would play that.
Yeah.
That's a bizarre song. So that's like super LSD influenced. Apparently, right. You know, there's a line in there that goes, she said, I know what it's like to be dead.
Yes.
And apparently that comes from a conversation that Harrison and Lennon had when they were with Peter Fonda. the movie actor. And because apparently Peter Fonda, when he was young, he technically died during an operation as a kid and came back to life, apparently. Wow. But he said they were talking and they were all on LSD and they were just like, you know, super high. And he said, you know, I know what it's like to be dead. And they were like, what?
And they, Easy they, Rider.
Right.
Yeah.
So yeah, they included that in the song.
You know, I kind of ended up hearing about that, and but to me it was like, this was one of those songs where I was really like, this is an interesting back and forth. Like, mm-hmm. I don't know if this is meant to be that way, but she said, I know what it's like to be dead. I know what it is to be sad. And she's making me feel like, it just feels like an argument between two people. And she's saying these things and he's never felt this way before because he's always just been a young. And now it's like you kind of growing up and having these conversations and these arguments with people that are just like all of a sudden just so mature and beyond like where you see yourself getting to with another human being. You know, like as you get older and you start experiencing people and you're experiencing different mindsets and people, and just like that's something that's been kind of hit home, I think, for me, especially when like moving out and encountering people with just different backgrounds or being brought up differently or just going through different things in life. They have different mentalities. You think you have like, you try and use your sense of humor with somebody. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't land. And you're like, well, that's landed with literally everybody else I've grown up with. Right. And you don't get it. And now I've actually offended you. And you know what? I'm just going to go drink over there. Right. This just kind of feels like this experience of meeting and running into somebody who just sees so much more differently than you. So mm-hmm. I'll end it there. But
Well, it was, you know, compare McCartney songs with Lennon songs. This is a Lennon song, and his lyrics are so like kind of biting and acerbic, right? And again, McCartney is kind of very, you know, romantic love based, and Lennon was very kind of skeptical, and you know, he would take shots at people, but. And this, again, this was the beginning of that, because previous to this, I mean, there were a couple of like albums like Rubber Soul and stuff like that, but like, it was like, please, please me and love me do. And, you know, everything was like, you know, cheeky and smiley. And now it's like, you know, the knives are going to come out.
Yeah. That's like Good Day Sunshine.
Yeah. Again, who's that? McCartney. See, and it's like the vaudeville. It's got like a ragtime feel, yeah. Like, you know, So I always think when I hear McCartney songs and Lennon songs about how they, like what the perception was.
Well, it's interesting because I was listening to people like fans of the Beatles talk and they're like, this is a skipper for me. I'm like, why would this be a skipper? I like, it's just a happy, you know, waltzing, like you said, vaudeville. Totally. Like, what's the problem with it?
It's like flouncy and kind of, you know, easy.
Yeah. And then it busts into And Your Bird Can Sing. What a killer song. Like these, like this guitar riff to me is super cool and like super inspiring. Like, yes. you can just hear. I mentioned Sloan. Like there's like a lot of Sloan, like I don't know, there's a lot of people that like this, but knowing that Sloan, the Canadian band, it's like, you know, really liked the Beatles and really inspired and influenced by them, like you kind of hear that now when you start listening to songs like this, even with Taxman, right, like some of these songs you're just like, even that she said you just, you can start to sort of understand, like you've heard some of this stuff before, you've heard it, you know, as you've listened through music, if you've never listened to the Beatles before. But yeah, I just feel like the guitar riff, the melody on this one is so good. And Your Bird Can Sing. So good.
You see what I mean when I say all roads lead back to the Beatles?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I mean, like, so tell me to pinpoint exactly what song it is. But it's like, no, it just sounds familiar. It just does. But really, they're taking from them. I understand the Beatles were first. I'm just saying.
Oh, no, yeah, but yeah. It's just really interesting when you look at it from a genealogical perspective, right?
Yeah.
And it's cool in sense of like you're discovering things like that because you're like Sloan is cool and oh my god,
yeah,
that's where they got that idea, maybe
totally,
right? So yeah,
and a bird can sing. A lot of like people aren't really sure where this came from, the idea of the song, and
there's theories, right? Like it's a, they said Bob Dylan, somebody said Sinatra, because right. I guess
yeah.
There was a story a long time ago that Lennon had read this. I think it was Esquire magazine. He read an article about Sinatra, and they were like, Sinatra is like the Renaissance man who can have everything he wants. And Lennon's right. like, whatever. So, yeah. Apparently, he wrote the song in response to that. I don't know if that's true or not, but.
Yeah, again, this is comes back to me. Like an argument or like, and I don't know if it's meant to be arguments. I don't want to be like negative here, but this is like, you tell me you got everything and your bird can sing, but you don't get me. You don't get me. Again, this feels like a relationship based thing. It's like everything you get, like you get your bird can sing, but you don't get me.
It's just that kind of duality between Lennon and McCartney. And I've always thought, and that this could be a huge reach on my part, but when you look very closely at the cover, this is McCartney. This is Lennon.
Looking away.
But look at the side eye, right? So McCartney's right. kind of petulant looking, right? Lennon is like looking at him. It's almost like there's a defiance there. And all the things that are between them, right? It's very symbolic.
That's so crazy you brought that up, because that's kind of what I was thinking when I saw that cover. I was like, why is McCartney looking away from Lennon? And Lennon's kind of like, you know,
right.
It did cross my mind when I saw that.
Yeah. See, it's funny because it's very uncharacteristic for McCartney to have such a petulant looking face. Hmm. He's usually like smiling like, hey, let's be friends, everybody.
Yeah.
Right. But so it's like they're fighting already.
Oh, Van Halen. Diver down.
Well, see, there you go. Maybe it was a warning.
Could have been fair warning.
McCartney walked out of She Said, She Said as it was being recorded, apparently. Yeah, he walked out of the studio. He wasn't happy with the way something was going.
For No One comes after And a Bird Can Sing.
Yeah, and again, McCartney. This is about Jane Asher, I think, his old girlfriend. They had just broken up, I think. Yeah, so again, romantic love. Nice little French horn solo there, too.
Yeah.
It's stylistically very different.
But good. It's good. Like, again, it's like, it's so well broken up, the album, with like different, again, instruments, as we've said, and orchestrations and compositions. Like it's just cool. It's cool. Yeah. It leaves you thinking, like, what's coming next? Because Dr. Robert comes after this, which is like another great little guitar riff that is just like, I love it. I love
this. This is one of my favorite Lennon tunes.
Okay.
This is like such a snide vocal delivery. And I'll tell you why. One thing that I always think about when I hear the song is in the first verse, the second line, he says something, he's available. It goes, do, 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 Dr. Robert, right? So there's a measure there. So you're supposed to kind of follow that measure, but he intentionally goes over that measure. I don't know if you know what I'm talking about, but he says he's available anytime, and he could have stopped and said Dr. Robert, but he said anytime at all, Dr. Robert, and he pushes it through, and it kind of throws off the whole kind of balance of the measure. But it's like John Lennon being John Lennon, right? He didn't have to say at all. He just kind of did it, and he pushes the vocal.
Interesting.
Yeah, it's like, listen to that. Like I don't know why he did that, but it's just, he's basically just saying,
yeah, yeah, you know, F you.
Right.
Is it McCartney that comes in and sings heavy with him? He's a man. Just to get a little bit of extra emphasis is the word I was looking for during that part of the chorus, which was neat. I want to tell you. I want to tell you how irritating this recording experience has been. Everybody, this is probably the 10th time we've had to stop and start recording like we talked about with our Halifax show. For some reason, we've got some weird technical thing. I shouldn't even be talking about it, but I am, because you know what? I'm going to break the fourth wall.
You broke the fourth wall. You did. But that's okay, because this is, I think this is our fifth restart. So
it might be even more than that, but yeah.
Play along at home and see if you can catch the edits.
Catch the edits. Let us know where you think it's happened. But I want to tell you, again, fun, flouncy little thing. Here's what I love about this song. They do this thing where the piano hits this weird, like, bana, 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 and it still works.
What? I'm so glad that you picked up on that, because that is the weirdest thing, right? It's sharp. Yeah. The piano is sharp.
Yeah.
And it sounds eerie and weird.
But they keep the same melody and the same, like, right. Everything stays the same.
Right.
But now all of a sudden the sphere, bana, 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 and you're almost kind of like, I want to change this, but it's actually so weird and disturbing that, like, mm-hmm. I'm actually going to sit through this. And the more you sit through it and the more you listen to it, the more you're like, God, this is so good. Why? Mm-hmm. Why is, like, this so good?
Musical genius, right?
I guess
I want to, it's weird because it's almost savant-ish. Like, I want to find out whose idea that was. It had to be like
Sting sat down on the piano at that exact moment and they were like, that worked. No,
it sounds like an accident that just gets perpetuated in that piano line. It's like sharp, 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 sharp. And you're like, well, why is that there? Oh my God. But it sounds kind of cool.
Well, that would have been a McCartney thing, right?
McCartney or George Martin, one of the two.
Okay.
I don't think Lennon came up with that. No disrespect, but definitely one of those two guys, I think. I'm gonna research that. I'm gonna find out whose idea that was. It's gotta be recorded somewhere.
It's gotta be somewhere, because that was like, it's so disorienting. Like when you hear it come in, you're like, what?
That's so cool that you picked up on that. I love that.
Yeah. I feel like it'd be hard not to be honest. I feel like it's just like it's there. But it's like whether or not you enjoy it or appreciate it is the other thing.
Mm-hmm. So it's super prominent, but you just come to accept it as part of the song.
Yeah. It could be a reason why people don't like the song, though. I could see that have being a reason why I was like, I wouldn't like it. But then I just kept listening to it. And I was like, I've got to be a genius. I have to be part of the genius that is the Beatles. And get this. I've got to get the Beatles into my life. I have to get you into my life.
There you go. Good segue.
Hey.
How about those horns in this song?
Killer.
Love it.
Love this. Love it.
It's just, again, and they're not soft. Like, they're harsh, right?
No.
It's like, you're just like, whoa.
Right at you. No? 100%. Just right in your face. I love it. Yeah. It's great.
And apparently McCartney requested that. He's like, I want this to be biting. Like, I want it to sound harsh. And apparently everybody was very flustered. Like, oh, it's not going to sound good. And he's like, no, it's got to be this way. Hmm. Mm-hmm. It sounds so cool, man.
And it's like, it's very, the way that this all leads up to the chorus, like the chorus is also very, like in a different way, you know, they really sing "Got to Get You Into My Life." Like, it takes this kind of different, like, turn. So it's almost like the horns are biting, but it's sort of a smooth verse. And then when you get to that chorus, it's like, got to get you into, you know, it's kind of have these really hard left right turns throughout the song, which is cool.
Yeah. I love it.
Yeah.
It's one of the best songs on the record for sure.
100%.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. Between this and End Your Bird Can Sing, it's probably the two of the best songs for me on this album.
Yeah. Dr. Robert, number 3.
Yeah. And Eleanor Rigby. I mean, there's a lot of really good songs on this album.
That's what I mean. Like, it's just, it's like so rich, right?
With
not just good songs, like great songs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Tomorrow Never Knows.
This is probably the biggest, like, fast forward that the Beatles pull off here, like, you know, away from like Love Me Do and Please Please Me into like the psychedelic kind of like, I don't care if you like this or not kind of mindset, right? Just like, you know, kind of take some LSD and float downstream. Yeah. Backwards looping. And yeah.
It's a cool way. It's a cool way to end it. It's sort of just like, hey, here's a reminder of all the things that we can do into one song, and here's your send off.
I think a lot of people heard that and they were just like, oh my God, like what is this band capable of?
Yeah, like
they just, probably. They've ruled the world for the past 3 years, really, right? Ruled the airwaves, had like 5 or 6 songs in the top 10 at all times, and then send off with this. Right. And it's like, wow, what is next?
And they never, so after this album, what, they never performed live again?
No. Do you know why? Because they couldn't hear themselves.
No. So they were deaf?
All four of them were deaf. Oh. No, they got drowned out by the crowd. Oh. Keep in mind, this is like 1965, right? 66. So yeah. They just had like little amps. They didn't have this like massive PA system that would blow people away. They had very modest instrumentation. And
so, you know, Beatlemania shut them down from touring. Yeah. That's wild.
Sometimes they weren't even, they would take a night off and not even sing, and they would just mouth the words and it didn't matter. Because seriously, that's true. Isn't that crazy?
That's incredible.
Yeah. And they made a joke of it.
That's so good. Yeah. Better save our voices tonight, boys. Who knows what will be tomorrow?
Yeah.
God. Perfect.
Kind of a fun fact about this record, too. Paperback Writer was written during that time, but never really had a home on any Beatles recording. It was just a single. But if you're looking for Paperback Writer on an album, you won't find it.
Cool. Well, right. I mean, I feel like I'm just following the crowd on this one with a 5 out of 5, but I mean,
you have to.
It is. I mean, what else are you going to do? What happens, you know?
Yeah. Well, how do you follow that up?
If I'm being honest, Brent, I think it has to be another Beatles album. You either take me further back, you take me one back, we go backwards. I feel like we might have to do more than two here. So you, I'll let you blaze the trail, but I'm just saying.
Okay, that is music to my ears. I propose that we do this one next. This is Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. And
this came after this one.
A gem. Yes, it did. So this is like a lot of people say this is their best record ever.
Okay.
So yeah, I mean, like it's equally killer. So.
All right.
I'll say no more until our next episode.
Let's see. Let's see what's going to, maybe I'll get Beatles out after this. Maybe that'll happen. Maybe it'll be too much Beatles.
I will tell you that even though they had a very short career, 63 to 70, there was so much good music packed into that short period of time. And again, so stylistically varied and thematically varied, really, psychedelia, you know, pop, all that stuff, that you have to kind of sample different portions of it. So we did Revolver, which was important. That was their psychedelic period, the entrance into. We'll do Sgt. Pepper, and maybe we'll do one more or two.
We could do a run here. I'm not going to be upset about it, I don't think. Okay.
No, I don't think you will.
Okay.
It's actually, if we're talking about like discovery and education, this is well worth the effort and the time.
Okay, let's do it.
All right. How many takes was that?
How many takes? Let me just count this.
How many pieces do we have to
1, 2, 3, together? 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. This will be 9.
So the show dropped off 8 times while we recorded this.
Yeah, yeah. And if we keep talking, it'll drop off a 10th time.
It will actually.
Yeah. Interesting. Interesting. All right. Well, on that note.
All right. Cheers.
I am not a crook. Cheers. See you, man.
Hey. And congratulations on 100.
Thanks. Yes. Can you believe it? How crazy is this? This is wild. I can't believe it. Wow. You did it.
You did it. Quick.